Welcome to Checkpoint This Week. My name is Vivian Kamsimi. By now, you are aware of Uganda hosting the Non-Aligned Movement Summit last week and the G77 plus China this week. Now, there have been a number of questions, numerous questions, about what Uganda stands to gain from hosting these summits and a general understanding of what hosting these summits means for Uganda. Now, we have brought you a historical perspective to the Non-Aligned Movement, NAM, about the legacy of Mwalimu Julius Nyerere in the movement. My guest is Professor Bazana Tasis Kabwejere, who is a sociologist, an academician, and politician. Welcome, Professor.
Thank you very much.
Professor, you are aware that we are having summits being hosted here in the country at Peak Resort Munyonyo. And we know that Mwalimu Julius Nyerere was once a leader in this movement. Tell us about his legacy within the Non-Aligned Movement.
Yeah, before I go into that, I'd like to congratulate the president of this country, Yoweri Kaguta Museveni, and all those who have organized these events. And above all, thank God that we didn't have the rain that could have
disrupted.
Yes. I you know, when you talk of miracles, when you talk of things that you can't even explain metaphysically, that we didn't have rain, because many of the events were outside in tents, people being driven, getting out of cars to go to meetings. If it was raining, it would have been terrible. So really, we have to be thankful that we have had this orderly, peaceful events. With all these people from different countries of the world, different corners, and coming here and really staying with us for the period that we have had. Now, to go to your question, I think Ugandans have reason to know Nyerere. Nyerere, the president of Tanzania. We add the word Mwalimu, which in Kiswahili means teacher. A teacher, a leader, and a great human being. Mwalimu Nyerere was the president of Tanzania, but I won't go into details of that. Ugandans know, if you don't know, now know, that President Obote, when he was overthrown, he stayed in Msasani for 8 years, the years Amin was in charge here, being hosted by Mwalimu Nyerere. Know, if you didn't know, that many Ugandans ran out of Uganda and stayed in Tanzania and were brought up, many of them, to political limelight by the guidance of Mwalimu Nyerere. And in particular, I'm saying this because he himself has said it. Yoweri Kaguta Museveni has said it the other day. He's a follower of Mwalimu Nyerere. He's a disciple of Mwalimu Nyerere. And many others. If you go into the decolonization process, the formation of AU in 63, Mwalimu Nyerere. If you go to the leadership of the frontline states, Mwalimu Nyerere. If you go to the organization of decolonization, these countries, Mozambique, Angola, and so on, they owe it to Mwalimu Nyerere as the leader. Burundi talks, but before that, Uganda, apart from hosting Nyerere, Obote, he also hosted the 1979 Moshi Conference, of which I was the convener. But imagine bringing all these Ugandans from all corners, different places, coming in, different organizations, and hosting us as we formed UNLF, Uganda National Liberation Front, to assist him execute the task of responding to the attack by Amin. That's Mwalimu. Okay? Mm. Now, in the context of this, Mwalimu is the founder of the South-South Commission. The South-South Commission is the organization of the countries of the South. He was the founder, leader, and chair of that commission. And what we are looking at now, this non-aligned movement, is the result
of the South-South Commission.
Commission. And of his leadership, I won't mention others because we don't have enough time. Mm. But certainly, he chaired the South Commission. Now, if you have a chance to have a look at this, this is the first time that a group of thinkers and practitioners, exclusively from the South, broadly reflecting interests and conditions of different regions and countries that make up the third world, will apply their collective mind, underline that, of a period of time to the issues of sustainable, people-centered, self-reliant development. By that is meant development that is socially just, economically efficient, and ecologically sound.
Okay.
Now, so when we are talking of the foundation of the Nyerere Foundation, which he founded, and we are now talking of the establishment of the Mwalimu Nyerere World Leadership Institute, we are trying to have a center where efficient. By this is meant development that is socially just, economically efficient, and ecologically sound. A center where these can be studied, so that we are not dependent on knowledge created for other purposes. We have knowledge created for us.
Mm. Yes. Sorry, I just needed to come in here and make something very clear. Mm. When you're talking about the South, some people might be thinking of it in the sense of being geographical. Mm. But also, I think what needs to come out during this conversation is that the non-aligned movements, at the time when it came out, we had a bipolar world where we had the capitalists, the socialists, but then we had these developing countries that decided to be neutral so that they would not be taken up in the big fight, the Cold War, between the capitalists and the socialists, and then you have them being called the South. So kindly explain to us that South, that you're talking about the South-South Commission,
yes,
and the nature of countries that were in it, and the politics of how they were participating in the world for them to actually get into NAM, and then just highlight for us his achievements in the NAM.
Well, in brief, the world over a period of time has been developed along the developed North and the poor South. And the North was the dominator. The colonial powers, Europe, America, those are the powerful. The economy is developed, dependent on us. You see, the South now, which are these countries? These are countries which were dominated, which were colonized.
Yes.
Okay? But even before colonization, which were depleted of citizens through slave trade, these are countries which have provided raw materials to the economies of the. These are countries where the trade, we send our raw materials to them and they produce goods, then we buy them at a higher price. So, when we are talking, therefore, of the South, we are talking of the countries which are emerging from colonialism.
Developing,
which are emerging from domination, and the domination of centuries. You know, slave trade, and slavery lasted how many years?
Over 100.
400 years, not just 100.
Mm.
Now, when we are talking like now, and you mentioned slave trade or slavery, somebody says, oh, that's something of the past. But the impact of 400, of 500, of the colonialist people sitting in Berlin and deciding that you go, you Germany go there, you France go there, you Britain go here, Germany here, and dividing the world among themselves. Now, if leaders of these countries, of our countries, don't realize that we are divided according to interest of the dominant powers, we are going to remain vegetables to be on the table. So the South South Commission, that's why Nyerere is a great man. Now, here is a title, Freedom and Liberation. You need freedom to liberate yourself.
Yes.
And liberation is not just taking over power, because liberation, more fundamentally, is the liberation of the mind.
Mm.
That's why in Uganda now we are talking of mindset change. We need to dig into the mind to clear out the debris of yesterday. Now, so you have this freedom and liberation. Then you have freedom, non-alignment, and South cooperation. Now, these South countries must cooperate, because if you are weak and you don't create strength, the dominator will continue vegetating on you. So the South Commission, the non-aligned movement, the 77, all these efforts are to build strength. And strength has to do with knowledge. So the Mwalimu Nyerere World Leadership Center Institute is to create knowledge and transmit it and have it consumed. Do the right research. For example, why did these countries dominate us? We need to answer that question to ourselves.
Are you saying that this institute is going to be educating Africans on a whole? What kind of people are you going to be admitting, and where are you going to build this institute?
The institute is going to be built in Dodoma, in Tanzania. We already have land there, 110 acres. So we are going to build a center of knowledge. And this is not a center that will be only for the South, because we must educate the North as well. We need new leaders up there who see the mistakes, who see the weaknesses of their system. Because whether we like it or not, the West, the dominating countries are collapsing. There is no doubt about that. Empires build and they end up collapsing. The North now has to depend on us as we merge with new ideas. So we are now going to liberate, not only liberate ourselves, but liberate the North. Because these people believed. That's why Mwalimu is so important. Mwalimu says, we are human. If I am human, why do you think that I have to depend on you? I have a heart, I have eyes, I have brain. Why do you think that you are superior to me? What makes you think that God made you superior to me? And that's why Nyerere says. That's why Nyerere talks about humanity, self-centered development, justice, not a gift, not dependent on loans from some source. You must build your own economy. You must build your own strength, your own confidence. And this has to do with knowledge. So they're a center of knowledge. You see, these fellows, they built their own institutions. The School of Oriental and African Studies. Okay? They produce people there to come and dominate us.
Well, one of the arguments of some analysts is that these summits that we have hosted, especially the NAM, may not have brought money into individual pockets of Ugandans, but these summits also help us to create influence that the South, talking about developing countries, the African countries at that, are able to use at the world table.
Yes.
And here we are able to influence world decisions, have a stand and take positions on certain issues that can be listened to because you're now a bloc. And at this time, the spotlight is all on Ugandans.
Yes.
And what is happening here. So whatever we could say now, or if we take a stand being part of this big group and communicate it, then the message can be heard. But
before you come, you go on. You see, people who are short-term centered, short-termism, they will think about money in the pocket. But what has happened here is an establishment of a new era, beginnings, a continuation of an era.
Mm.
Okay? We are talking of 60 years. We are going to celebrate 60 years of non-alignment. 60 years in human history is what? There are people who think, 30 years, 60 years. We were under colonialism for what period? The whole of Africa.
You said slavery for over 400 years.
And slavery.
And you birthed colonialism.
Yes. So money is a tool, even to make money. People are saying, like, there are people who are saying Ugandans into slavery. Like those days, they want to make money, so they send people into some slavery. Because of
lack of mindset change.
Yeah, of not knowing that what money is a tool. If you get it and you misuse it, you are a problem. Nyerere, you cannot go to Tanzania and find big farms, big buildings of Nyerere. But Nyerere is a world figure. He's going to be here for millions of years. People will know Nyerere, not because he had money in his pocket. So what we are really talking about is a liberation of the mind, a liberation, a creation of our new consciousness, and to know that we have a capacity, and as the president himself said it, we are even the origin of man. Man originated here, and people don't know, if they didn't know that, man originated here on the continent of Africa, and not far away within this region, in any case, Kenya, Tanzania, Uganda, we are the center of all this. But we have been given an impression that we are less human. And yet we are the quintessence of humanity. Now, so what Mwalimu really presents is, look, you are the origin. Yes.
There have been reports that he played a great role in Uganda's post-independence history.
Very much.
And from giving Obote advice to helping the overthrow of Amin,
yes,
and helping NRM get into power, actually,
yes, yes,
what would you say Uganda could have been without the help of Obote? What would
of
we
Obote
have
or
become? What would we have become without the help of Mwalimu?
Well, that one I can't speculate. Because how could, for example, how Kabwejere, who would I be if I didn't encounter Nyerere in my life? I have always asked myself, how did he find confidence that I could convene a meeting and bring the people to come and we hold a meeting there? That's one of the dramas of my existence. But apart from that, he chaired the Burundi talks, and President Yoweri Museveni sent me there. I was then special envoy in the Great Lakes region, and we were in the Burundi talks. If you check the work he did to get the Burundi before he died, because he died before the conclusion, to get the Burundi, the Hutu and the Tutsis, to realize that you're human, the Hutu does not breathe special air or ignorant or stupid air from the Tutsi, that we are all the same people. And that's how we worked out a formula that has reduced the tensions in that country. This is the man who chaired that meeting and he would really advise you what is the difference between you and him. That is the Mtusi, that is the Hutu, Mhutu. What is the difference? Now that's the man. Okay? Now for Uganda, apart from what I have said that he hosted,
but the South.
Yes, you know he hosted Obote, but he supported us to remove the rule of Amin. Not the man, but the rule. People think when you talk of that, you are hating Amin as a man. No, no, no. It is what he represented. He was a product. He was a representation of something he wasn't able to control himself. I don't think Amin had the capacity to understand what he was doing. That I'm sure. Okay?
Okay.
Yes. So, Nyerere, in fact, Ephraim Kamuntu and me, when we came back from Moshi, we proposed and wrote a paper proposing that we should have a Republic of Tanzaganda, that Uganda and Tanzania should form one republic and forget the differences because of what Nyerere had done.
I think that would take so much, especially in the era that we are in. But one of the reasons
the era we are in is the era of creating new consciousness to realize that East Africa should be together.
One country.
Africa should be together. Do you know that India has a population about the same size, if not slightly, of Africa, and they have one government? China has a population. But we
talking about that idea, you bring in the idea of Pan-Africanism.
Yes.
But also, one of the reasons why that Pan-Africanism, in the sense that we can have one governance, has been looked at as a challenge, is that Africans have so much diversity. And every tribe tries to look at itself as us. So this divide and rule formula that came from the north was able to work on us, because every time they showed you how different you are from another tribe, then you felt the urge or the need to defend your own stand or your own rights against the other person who you thought was different from you. And I think that's where his ideology of saying we are one people
came from. Yes, yes.
But we also had other strong men on the continent that were in support of this Pan-Africanism, like Kwame Nkrumah. How was Mwalimu Julius Nyerere's approach different from men like Kwame Nkrumah?
It wasn't different. They formed the United Nations, the OAU, together in 1963. No, it wasn't. There was no difference. Well, some wanted immediate, the Casablanca group, and this group, they wanted immediate now. But these are all efforts. You see, if, for example, as we are talking here now, a lion walked into this program, into this studio, your reaction to it and my reaction may be different, okay, in our effort to save ourselves. But the moment we agree that let's fight the lion together, then we create strength. That's what Mwalimu talks about. That's what the formation of African unity, that's what the formation of the South-South Commission, that's the whole question about the non-alignment, the countries coming together. There are differences, all right?
We have it now, we have it later.
Yes, these differences, you fight them. Eh? You reduce them. You have a program. You have, in fact, if you had time, you would see what program they set up. Hmm? What do we do first? Eh? We have now an agenda, right? For following now the next 3 years, but the next 60 years, what will we achieve? Now, the South, these countries, have a challenge of working together to be closer. To be closer. The North has been...
And speaking one voice.
Yes, yes. Hmm. The North has been trying to be close, but you see wars bring them out. For example, the Russian... this war going on.
In Ukraine.
Yeah, is separating them, you know. The Gaza, huh? now, this is disintegrating them, because when America comes in to support Palestine, I mean support Israel, and others are saying, so all of this, that's why the North is collapsing, whether we are likes it or not. While us, we should be now looking at how we build the strength to take over the world. You know, Mwalimu has this freedom and a new world economic order. Many of the things that are happening in the world today, you don't have to be a Marxist that to know that economic factors underlie all this.
Mm.
Their survival, the survival of the North, depended on us. Okay? The building of the economy in America was built on slave trade, on slave labor. Okay? Now, if you don't realize this, that strength, technology coming in, now technology is not west, is not east, and whatnot, we now we are innovating ourselves. Now, so that's why you need a center. That's why our universities must teach a new must have a new orientation, that we are entering a new era. The 21st century, in fact, I gave a talk at the University of Choto in Japan in 1988. Somehow I said, the world is going to be led by Africa, is going to be led by the people in the South, because the North is collapsing. The North is collapsing. And it is collapsing because of their mistakes, because of their greed, because of not realizing that human beings are the same. That we need air to breathe together, we need food to eat. We don't say, I am, and I am depending on you. And you step on me, you step on my nose, I can't even breathe. You are stepping on my neck, you break it. That has been a belief which is now negating the survival of that system. Now that's why the meeting that has taken place here is an opening eye. You were saying at the beginning that we don't even know this, yes, it is our fault, perhaps the older generation, that we have not brought you with the knowledge. Okay? Why are we weak?
On knowledge at that.
Yes.
But let me just point, because I want this legacy of the Mwalimu to be clear in this particular new world order that you're explaining.
Yes, yes.
Now, Mwalimu Julius Nyerere ran Tanzania as a single party state, and Tanzania still clamps down on opposition.
It didn't clamp down on opposition. You see, opposition is not necessary. You don't have to have opposition to do right.
Is that the belief of the socialists?
No. If you are going to consult anybody to swallow your food, that because you need somebody to be opposing or tell you what is what, therefore you refuse to swallow your food, you will die. Opposition, the institutionalization of opposition is again part of the weaknesses of the West.
In your view, we should not have an
opposition. No, it's not a question of not have. If you know the answer of a problem, please take it, bring it on the table.
If you don't take it?
No, it's not a question. When you don't take it, it's because you're ignorant. You see, good is good. There is no good for the opposition, there is no good for government, the people in government. Right. That's what objective things are there for all of us to benefit from. For example, a road is not there for people in the opposition or people in the electricity, for people in government. So what we are talking about, and this is where we need to go beyond the ordinary thinking that we have now, that we are looking...
The idea of opposition is such that there is this person in power who, by the way, should be chosen by the people, and should have a timeline on how far their rule can go, but then has a voice of where things may not be right. And if they are not, and this person is not able to listen, then we can endure that rule for some time and then have another rule. So if we don't have that...
No, I have no objection. I have no problem with that.
Yes.
The issue is, if we knew exactly what we all want to do, there would be no problem. But given man's limitations, that's why the system must allow for alternative thinking, so that in the process you can get a better understanding, a better solution. The issue is not that you must oppose. That would make no sense. The issue is, if somebody says this is good, has he or she gone through the whole question, the dynamics of understanding? Is he giving us the best answer? If he's not giving the best answer, and you can't present it with him, you then oppose him or her, so that other people can see. That is, you have an alternative. Opposition, if it doesn't have alternative, and it is only for the sake of opposing, that is absolute rubbish. It's a waste of energy. So the whole concept of one party, for example, in Tanzania, you bring everybody in, one language, Swahili. You want a road, everybody needs a road. Education, we need all of it. If you have an idea, bring it in. Am I refusing it? If I'm refusing it, then you have a point. Then people will say, he has refused it, so let's follow you. If you know the way.
So now, if people want to follow you, and for example, in Tanzania now, we have Chama Chama Pinduzi,
yes,
still struggling opposition. Do you think now, he could have laid a foundation to continue this rule of a single party?
That statement you've said is strangling. You know, strength is the determinant of success.
Yes.
Yes. If you are weak, you are eaten. If you are a cob, you are eaten by a lion. If you check, why is it the case that Chama Chama Pinduzi has been the party, leading party in Tanzania all these years since independence? It is because its foundation was not just Nyerere. It was not just 1 year or 2 years. It is an address to problem, to fundamental problems.
Mm.
Yes. Now, if you are a leader who addresses fundamental problems, there is no reason why you should be thrown out. I have objection, very strong objection, to this idea that the woman representing a district should only be given 2 terms. Just because an affirmative action. In fact, let me say this very clearly. How can it be an affirmative action when she represents the whole district, where there are other MPs representing constituencies? She has a bigger task than a simple constituency.
Mm.
So affirmative action is, in fact, I wouldn't, if you asked Kabweje to represent the whole Bushenyi, I would say no. But there is a woman representing the whole Bushenyi. What a challenge. So, the whole question is, do we know, do we design a system that has objective reality, addresses the objective reality, and helps everybody on board? If the opposition is saying we are doing A, B, C, D for the better, like I hear that they were supposed to demonstrate here because there are potholes in Kampala, when we are having these visitors here, that they wanted to demonstrate, what is that an achievement? What is that supposed to achieve? That if when you do that, you walk on the streets, like walk to work, you create jobs, or you fill holes, potholes.
Well, it is the voice of dissatisfaction to whatever is going on, and of course the fact that they feel not heard.
What is
so
the dissatisfaction
they want to go
based
to those
on?
Extents.
What is the dissatisfaction based on? Present knowledge, present the way, and people will follow you.
You are a sociologist.
Yes.
And an academician in this field. Mwalimu Julius Nyerere was a socialist, and he had a policy, the Ujamaa policy, that even failed. Can you explain to us what exactly he wanted to achieve with this policy?
I wanted you to give me reason why you said it failed. You know?
Is it still prevailing now?
Is Tanzania worse off than Uganda?
So in your view, it is not?
No, you see, this is the whole question about if you know what Ujamaa was and how he tried it and how he adjusted and how he moved. You see that you are dealing with a man or a person who tried to do good, and where he found problems, he adjusted. If you came in with an alternative argument, he accepted it. He wasn't a monopolist of thinker. He was a versatile thinker, a universal thinker, where the best is achieved through a combination of efforts. So the fact that Tanzania has one language, because there are people who resisted the teaching of Swahili, but now they are happy about it. When I go there, I am lost. When they choose to talk in Swahili, I am lost. Now, that is the basis of a better society. Now we are trying to adopt Swahili here. All right? We are trying. We want it for East Africa. So when you say that there are weaknesses, these weaknesses are here. Even when we are talking of the North, weaknesses are there. In fact, now there are weaknesses, bigger weaknesses there than probably they are here. Okay? For us now, if we can unite, if we can think together, if we can do enough research as to why certain actions should be taken, we are in a better strength, historically speaking, than the North. Okay?
Mwalimu was in power in presidency for about 15 years, and now our very own President Yoweri Museveni, who is his disciple, has been in power for about 38 years. Mm. Do you think that President Museveni has upheld Mwalimu Julius Nyerere's legacy?
First of all, the two are not comparable. That would be, to me, would be, you know, Nyerere founded Tanzania. He, pre-independence, he was there. And he got independence. And he structured that country according to principles which have kept it united. You have not had a coup in Tanzania. You had an attempted one in Kenya, but you have not had a coup. They had all these neighbors, Sudan, Congo, you know, you have had coups. Why? So there is something that you should learn about Nyerere. And he stood not to be admired for the sake of it. No. Look, how many leaders in Africa, and indeed the world, have you heard, are being considered for sainthood? Every 3rd of June in
Namugongo,
we pray for his recognition as a saint. Do you see? How many do you know? Would you have Amin or Obote or Benaisa and so on, or Rule, being considered for sainthood? So there is something very unique. There is something that Nyerere got honors from over 20 countries. No, many. Because he was given degrees, honors, titles, almost everywhere he went, in those different countries. Go to Oxford, go to Cambridge. They teach Nyerere's ideas. What is socialism according to Nyerere? Ujamaa. Huh? Instead of us talking about, you know, Marx and so on, we have him. We have people who think, and we should be studying them and to see how they are relevant. Because you see, if you want to understand what goes on in Karamoja, you need to know why the system evolved to be what it is. And if you are going to change it, you need to have an understanding from the inside how it you can change it. You see, so Mwalimu was a thinker, okay? And not a limited thinker, a Tanzanian thinker. That's why he was leading different countries. Go to Mozambique, they will tell you about Nyerere. Go to Uganda here, people will say Nyerere. Go name them. And then in the south, all these countries, he went, traveled all these countries to form the commission. And he's now remembered. And that's why we came here, so that the south countries, the non-aligned countries, recognize that we now need a center. Funded. We need about $150 million to start it. Funded, so that we now, a new world order. Now, you see, this is the whole thing. Mm-hmm. Freedom and a new world economic order. The economic order affects the social order. You are talking of a sociologist.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. The study of society. How do human beings behave? Why do they behave the way they behave? How do you bring changes in the society? That is, now we are talking of a world economic order. And a world order, who is going to lead it? On what principles is it going to be led? Because the old order is collapsing.
As we conclude the show, Professor, you were a minister
way
back, you know, Obote's government, President Yoweri Museveni's government.
I was never in Obote's government. No. Yes.
Were you a minister before President Museveni?
79, 80, yes.
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 Whose government was that?
That is the UNLF. That is when we had Rule, and then we had Venisa, and then we have Military Commission. Yes.
How is life out of being a minister now?
Well, how do I look? I haven't changed in color. I haven't changed. No, what you should be asking is, do I have any perspective being in government, out and being in it again? Do I have a message that I can share with those who are in? Because now there are things I see a lot better than when I was in. For example, we need planning more than we have been doing. We need, for example, today, by 2050, Uganda will be over 100 million. Okay? 27 years from now. 27 years from now, you will still be a young lady. So, how do we handle that 100 million? How will we educate it? How will we organize it for production in education and all that? It needs people who are a think tank, who are sitting down and looking there, and looking here, and looking in all corners to see how that will work.
Do we have such people in government?
No, you see, that's the whole point. I'm saying this. I said we need it, okay? Because there is a lot of short-termism I have seen. And I'm saying this very clearly. You know, that's why people are saying, is this conference bringing us money in the pocket? Instead of realizing that we are entering a new era, are we thinking beyond now? Okay? Now, so that's one. Two, people think that when you are a president, when you are a minister, there are benefits you are getting. Therefore, get out so that other gets benefits. That's why I gave you an example of Nyerere. You want to go to Tanzania and they tell you, this is an estate of Nyerere, this is this of Nyerere. No, because he is a liberator, because he's a thinker, he's a helper, a destiny helper. Your leadership is about finding the way for people to follow you and get away from a worse situation to a better situation.
Mm.
Yeah. So when Museveni, President Museveni, people say he has been here for long. Yes, but who is there with a better alternative idea that you can follow? Compare this period he has been around with the period before. Okay? Did you realize that this year, October 9th, will be 62 years, as the 62 years we had of the British?
No.
Okay? So you compare these two. If you look at what has Uganda achieved, what is Uganda look like now in these 62 years of our independence, and what differences have been made by the presence of the leadership of NRM, then you can see comparatively the 62 years of colonialism, the years before Museveni came in. You look at those and see, we were better off then, or where are we better off now?
No.
Yes.
I just need to ask you one last question, because our time is fast spent. Mm, mm. What are your parting shots?
Well, what an opportunity we have that these countries, people came from different countries and came here. And literally, those of us who are watching them, who have been with them, they felt at home. Would Uganda have hosted this kind of organization, this kind of meetings during their mean time? Okay? Don't we know that there are countries where such a thing would not happen? So, has this happened by accident? It is by organization. Are there weaknesses? Of course, weaknesses are all over the place. Even in our individual organization, there are weaknesses. But if somebody has any idea to contribute it to making a better situation, rather than go to tell the world, go to America, tell the world, like the one I had was saying, how could you have this meeting in Uganda when you have Museveni? When in fact people came, because there is Museveni here. You can see the contradiction.
Mm.
Yes, and you are a leader, and you think you can get there and run a country. Finally, leading a country is not a joke. You just don't wake up in the morning and you are a president of Uganda. And you make an impact. You don't get a presence of Uganda and have as many years as Museveni has had, and you think anybody can have it like that. No. There is a need that has been met by a presence of a leadership. And it's not Museveni alone. He has had people working with him. In fact, what we are looking for is creating a cohesive leadership. Okay? More thinking together, more acting together, and solving problems together. That will lead Uganda into a better instrument in the region. And let me say this, Uganda has made a contribution, be it in the Congo, be it in Sudan, be it in Rwanda, be it in Burundi, be it, never mind, Museveni has made a difference in the region. And let me also tell you, if his ideas were welcomed by his colleagues in the region, East Africa would have been one country, would have been a federation. He sent me to America in 1997 to study how the American Federation is funded by the different states, so that here we can check the different states how they could fund a federation. 1997. And that report I gave him, he distributed it among leaders in East Africa. In 1997, we are still not yet together.
Wow.
Yeah.
So lots of research goes on into right. the country to yes. actually form it.
Yes. So, but finally, let's really thank God very, very firmly. Those of you listening, watching, let's thank God that we really had this period showing that we can host so many countries, so many people, and come out with one experience. I hope it builds a future for the whole world. A new era is engineered by these ideas.
Professor Tarsis Bazana-Kawejire, with me, Vivian Kamsimi, on Checkpoint this week. Until next week.